Good afternoon and welcome to today's seminar in Ukrainian studies hosted by the Ukrainian Research Institute. My name is Emily Channel Justice and I'm the director of the Temerte Contemporary Ukraine program at the Institute. And I'm delighted today to be joined by Kateryna Iakovlenko, who is a contemporary art researcher and art critic. She has an MA in journalism and social communication from the Donetsk National University. She worked as a deputy web editor at the Day newspaper from 2013 to 2014, and then as a curator and program manager for the Donbas Studios research project at Izolyatia Platform for Cultural Initiatives from 2014 to 2015, and then as a researcher and public program curator at Pinchuk Art Center from 2015 to 2021. She's currently a Fulbright research fellow at the Shevchenko Scientific Society here in the United States in New York. And today she'll be talking to us about Ukrainian contemporary art after 2014. If you're joining us on the Zoom webinar, please feel free to submit your questions via the Q&A function at any point during the talk. And if you're joining us on YouTube, then you can submit your questions via the YouTube chat function and they'll be passed on for us to address during the Q&A function. Kateryna, thank you so much for being here with us.
Yeah. Thank you, Emily. And it's a really great pleasure to me to have a talk here at Harvard. And probably I will start screen sharing now. So you will see my presentation. I want to start with one very important project. To my point of view, it's called Zashid. And it's made by Vova Voretnyov, artist who was born in Western Ukraine in place that have a rural tradition. And he did it in 2017. His work exemplifies how simple artistic gesture and social experiments gain social and political power. The artist walked across Ukraine from his hometown, Chervonograd, in West, to Lysychansk to East, the Eastern city that he could go for. And he exchanged coal from one mine to another. The artwork's title is hard to translate to other languages because it has a little game words. Like, for example, we can read like West, East, and also to East, and also we can read word of walk. Therefore, already its linguistic level, it has these games and express the features of unity, similarity, and regional's uniqueness, which makes the region's culturally rich. And he's walked across Ukraine. The artist recorded and posted on his Instagram page various places and locations, landscapes, and how everyday life is organized there. This exemplifies deliberate homeliness and what makes us similar to one to another. This personal living thought is more important to me than any external effect, commented Voretnyov. However, for Ukrainian art environment, his personal experience become an external effect and understanding of how one can reach beyond the controversial critical art, beyond social network and technologies. With this kind of archaic gesture walking across all the country from west to east, Voretnyov created a multi-layered artistic image presenting an opportunity to talk about the problems of ethics and uncompromising nature of the artistic gesture. So going back to the Euromaidan and war context, I want to... I need to share my presentation again. I'm so sorry for that. So going back to Euromaidan topic, I want to emphasize why it's important. And when Euromaidan was starting and war was started, it's brought new questions and new topics to Ukrainian art and inspired many young artists to use different media against the Russian propaganda. They also start reflected on their own history and look through archives, discussing political questions and et cetera. So archival impulse become very essential to this time. And for example, the film Grey Horses, written, directed, edited, and produced by Kharkiv-born artist Mykola Rydny, introduces several plot lines. One described unknown Ukrainian anarchist, Ivan Krupski, great-grandfather of film author, who switched between several ideological camps during the Civil War in 1917-1921. He lived out his life in a village and was almost forgotten unless counting the disrespect of his relatives. Another narrative stance deals with the lives of present-day young anarchists. In the films, they gathered, donated provision and clothes for IDP people and migrants, play war games in the forums.
Kateryna,
yeah.
I'm sorry, would you mind sharing your screen one more time? We're having trouble seeing it.
Yes.
Thank you.
So is it working now?
Not yet.
Could you see? So yeah, another narrative stands deals.
Sorry, we're still not seeing it. I don't know if we should have.
I don't know. It's I just.
I still can't see it. I can try sharing the PDF that you sent to me, and I can just.
Okay. Let's do this.
Go through. Sorry, everyone. It'll take me just 1 second to get the document, but. I'll be ready in just a second.
Second field, which is the center of attention of the artist, is the contemporary situation and the life of contemporary anarchists who helping IDP people, who helping migration, who also like trying to play like war games in the forest, and also like talking about revolution and war itself, and like reading some manifestos, and finally using these parallels between different times and mixed reality and fiction, the film poses questions about controversial surrounding and the construction of historical memory and glorifying historical figures about the current political agendas. And the gray horses, and as an excellent ideological metaphor grounded in natural change of the color of horses, that could turn gray after white and black. Thus, both great-grandfather in the film, as well as activists in present, who can constantly change their views and preferences, might be thought as the great horses. I also need to note that moving image and moving image art during Maidan become a crucial because of like democratic nature and fast, easy production. Many artists could do like very fast artistic reaction to everything what was going on at the time in Ukraine. So memory and history of Ukraine for some artists become essential, and they argue that Ukrainian society can solve their problems without dealing with the past and taking lessons from it, and especially not looking for traumatic and politically problematic topics. And for example, another artist, Nikita Kadan, he works with very problematic and fragile topics of Ukrainian history in his pogrom series that was made in 2016-2017. He used photographic documentation from Lviv pogrom in 1941. In his artistic practice, Kadan also used photographs from victims from Volynsk massacre, victims from the NKVD, and as well as civilians and prisoners murdered by the Nazis. In his works, addresses the manipulation of the photographic images of crimes whose interpretation depends on the unposed framework. So we can see in this slide the exhibition view from Stone His Stone, the solo exhibition that made in the context of Pinchuk Concert, where I worked for a while and where I was assistant to curator. So this is three pictures of Nikita Kadan's works. And also we can go for next slide. This is another one. So this with their simplified expressionist form and the black-white color scheme, the drawings resemble image from old newspapers, and they universalize events from the distant past through understanding and avoidance of details, inscribing them in iconography of pogroms, victim sharing common characteristics. After many years, photographs of victims may happen to be the only evidence, but they can also sometimes become an object of appropriation and ideological games of memory. According to the artist, photographic manipulations for propaganda purpose and extension of the history of crime. Last year of his big solo exhibition was made, and also we create a book and you can find it English version available on the website of Pinchuk Concerto. On the next slide, you can see the title of it. So it's fully published on the website, and yeah, you can go and read and see the whole exhibition view of Nikita. But he is not important only because of his corpus of art, but also because he doing a lot of activism in artistic field, and not only. So for example, in 2019, he became a head of contemporary art department and the research program Committee Museum of Fine Arts, and explored the phenomenon of Committee Museum, its history and its collections. So in the next slide, you can see the buildings of Committee Museum of Fine Arts is a unique institution located in a small village in Zhytomyr region, and it's very close to Kyiv. In museum's collection included about 3,000 artworks, including paintings, graphics, sculptures, and decorative arts made after Second World War, and it's mostly connected to post-war period in USSR. So Gesture of Attitudes exhibition program created by Nikita Kadan was consisted of 5 episodes and several following events. And one of this exhibition was titled War in Museum. And it was dedicated to exploring the ways of seeing war, both Soviet war, like Soviet understanding of Second World War and contemporary war in Donbas. There are many works devoted to the topic of Second World War because of his founder, Josef Buchanchuk, was a retired army officer and a World War II veteran. Museum's collection was formed in Soviet ideas of war and the way of the Great Patriotic War. Combining Soviet ideological artworks and contemporary paintings, drawings, and videos, an exhibition titled War in Museum shows how political mythologies today works. And mostly for this exhibition was chosen female optics. And you can see on the next slide how the exposition view was created. So on the top, you can see the series of drawings of Ladarovko. It's called Kiev Diary, and it was made in 2013, 2015. And it's very connected to Maidan processes. Ladarovko said, never mind how for a while I suspended my ability to tell apart from real events and metaphors. Ralko noted this boundary of unawareness and of the perceptions of the real and the virtual and the imagined and the things happening right before your eyes. I often use deliberate absurd of unreal imaginary to document real events with almost perception. Ralko notes that she didn't draw war and she just drew reality that changed because of it. And it changed everywhere, not just on the front lines, but everywhere. And suddenly it became clear that none of the mechanism from a normal peaceful life still work. So in 2013, euphoria, we can go to the next slide and see some other couple examples of her work from this diary. So in 2013, euphoria united people against the common enemies, the president, the government, and their chosen political turn. The media always emphasized this using force of the revolution. However, the general pathos of the victory over the president who felt the country on the revolution itself on the Maidan was also accompanied by the considerable pains like death, ruins, histories, lost hopes, and then also by the war which resulted from unresolved issues and political upsequence that had opened up. This post-field underliers was reflected in Ladarovko's diary, which was mentioned above. The artist creates a dozen and thousand of paintings and drawings in its automatic writing. She drew right here and right now. She was driven by empathy to the protesters, thinking the first and foremost about the nature of human beings and possibility to place for humanity in the stream of violence. Another example is also very crucial for that moment. We can go to the next slide and see some drawings of Valentina Kahidze, who also create a dozen of drawings of that times. So Valentina Kahidze was born in Donbas region, so she very connected to that region. And she was growing up in Ukrainian Georgian family. After a while in the 90s, she moved to Kyiv region and she was applying to Academy of Fine Arts while her family was staying there. During her phone, she speak with her mother who was living on occupied area and talking about Euromaidan and war. Her daily routine during wartime considered of quite familiar scenes. She grew vegetables and salads in the market and socialized with their neighbors. The telephone was only one way to Kahidze to communicate with her mother. And their daily conversation were discussed the person experiencing war's everyday life and really vivid an alternative view of military events. Based on these conversations, Kahidze was created a kind of artistic diary from more than 4 years in which she describes and draws the life along on the front line from her mother's words. In winter 2019, Alevtina Kahidze's mother died in a checkpoint. My mother, whom many knows as Strawberry Andreevna, died yesterday at the DPR checkpoint. Many prisoners, go through these processes, traveling from uncontrolled territories to collect their Ukrainian pensions. She left her house at 4 a.m, but never reached the territory controlled by Ukraine. According to DPR, her death from heart stops at 10:25, and it turned out that in 5 hours, she did not even get to the checkpoint. That's Kahidze wrote on her Facebook. Kahidze's personal story raised profound issues of everyday military life, such as ordinary people crossing front lines, social benefits, healthcare, informational policy, and etc. Kahidze's drawings were helped viewers to see war differently. The story of a real woman that characters once again relieved war and civilians' complex of the inhuman relationship. Previously, based on these works, Kahidze created a Facebook page, a play was staged, and the fragments of the dialogues was included to many other skill works. The voice of Strawberry Andreevna at some point began appeared on different platforms. It came up in public and political discussions. However, state and public sympathy for the problems of the woman who coined living in the other side of the front is a rare example of criticizing war and violence by exposing one's own problem. Strawberry Andreevna's story about the personal experience and a state and a society become a way to declare one's democratic and liberal views. Through Kahidze's storytelling, her mother's voice transcended from the precarious war victim to a non-defend and tolerate by the stage. So we can see one, two more couple examples of Kahidze works in the next two slides. In the next one. And then go to another example of open group that was called Synonymum for Weight and realized by open group during Hope exhibition, National Ukrainian Pavilion on Venice Biennale 2015. And this work includes live streaming video, 6 photographs and performance. A video wall composed of 9 screens transmits live streams from 9 front doors on the family homes of recent drafted Ukrainian soldiers, all living in different parts of the country. To the backside of the screens are framed photographs of the family's dinner table, a hung referring to the life benefits their doors. During the exhibition, one member of open group sits on the front on the live stream in a similar typical Ukrainian table, waiting for soldiers to return home and refusing to eat, drink during this period. This work moves between presence, absence, and anticipation. The performative act requires a test of endurance, which is quietly shared by the families and soldiers and Ukrainian society. It expresses hopes for the soldiers to return to their home after the conflict. Through its simple and honest forms, this work deals with social desires and fears. It reveals and the helplessness of people drawn into the violent conflict while suggesting the hopes and allows them to find new ways of making life go on. The basic structure of open group also involves different people, workers, soldiers, artists, and etc. Group works is based on research on the interaction and communication between people, artists, situation, and the place. In 2019, they presented Ukrainian National Pavilion and Venice Biennale as a curator, and their project, The Shadow of a Dream, cast upon Giardini Biennale, was a remarkable. So we can go to the next slide to see. According to the project over Venice, on the opening day on Biennale on May 9 at 12 at noon, the Mriya plane, the strategic air cargo plane, was designed by Antonov Design Bureau in Ukrainian USSR during 80s, had flyover. Mriya is a Soviet and Ukrainian legend, and its title literally translated as a dream. On board should have been a hard drive with the address book of all Ukrainian artists living today. For this project, the Open Group collaborated with the Minister of Culture, Minister of Defense, and Antonov Design Bureau. However, the plane was unable to fly due to the conflict between President Petro Poroshenko and the Minister of Defense. Nevertheless, the project has happened, and it was built on the storytelling about this conflict of interest, corruption, and the mistrust of authorities. In addition, a book with artist contacts was printed and supplemented with all the official letters that artists received from ministers and other governmental organizations. And it's important to mention that Soviet Union Pavilion, created in early 20th century in Venice Biennale, was invested by Bohdan Khanenko, a Kyiv-based art collector and a businessman. Also, Ukrainian artist has a long history of participation in Biennale during USSR and under the label of Soviet art. However, after USSR collapsed, Russia took the pavilion to them as a legal successor. And the result, Ukraine, as other republics, lost their pavilion, and like many other countries, were through to the periphery. So open group project turns the critical agenda and problemized the idea of Ukrainian dream in a strong connection with the post-colonial critique. Another significant trend of that has settled in the recent years of Ukrainian art, it's a need of community work. So we can go to the next slide and see a couple of examples of it. So one of the important organization, it's a Method Fund. It's an independent nonprofit organization that supports and develops contemporary art and culture in Ukraine by initiating research, education and exhibition projects. And created by artists and critics, the Method Fund focused on the search and on the forms on art institution and would meet the present requirements and the within connection to local context and give knowledge to the context of Soviet art. Another example is the Luhansk contemporary, the diaspora. And you can see in the next slide, their cover of music album. So Luhansk contemporary diaspora appeared in 2015 as an artistic union of artists and musicians displaced by the war. Today, the association includes some artists who lived on both sides of the front line. However, the basis of their language is still electronic music, in which freedom and the rights of expression dominate over physical borders, violence, and war. On next example, we can see work from another group. One more example of this community work is Atelier Normalne. It's a group of artists with and without the Down syndrome who have worked together as a self-organized artistic studio. It was created and founded by Stanislav Turina, Kateryna Vipkind, Valeria Tarasenko, and Olena Vasik in autumn 2018 with the support of Goethe Institute. By today, Atelier Normalne working in Kyiv and Odessa and has more than 20 participants. And one of the key authors, it's Alexander Stashenko. He is a writer, actor, and visual artist who mostly working with the script writing and created several films with the help of other artists. One of the, the first his film is called International Doors to Europe and explores problems of geopolitical wars and cultural stereotypes. This film problematized the political and cultural concepts of Europe as well as the concept of New East. In his second movie, and the next slide, in memory of Antonina Nikolaevna on lost love, Stashenko uses cliches from popular contemporary Ukrainian and Russian TV soap dramas, reflecting on so-called norma, helping and the mentally stable society with a nuclear family in its core. Using specific language and grammar, Stashenko creates a notable image of ordinary family and shows how politically and culturally disoriented, blind, and unhappy society could be. During the last decades, feminism and women's rights question have become the powerful discussion in Ukraine too. So this is the next topic that I want to brought. So for example, this topic was explored by Valentina Petrova and Anna Shevchenko in their sister's episode made for the Arm and Dangerous Project. And actually Arm and Dangerous Project is also was curated by Makola Ridney as a way to gather different people from different fields like artists, filmmakers. He just gave them a topic and they create a different episode for one TV show. So it's very connected to contemporary culture and contemporary tradition of making movies. And the authors describes films as a story of struggle for unique rights and denying their nails. So they said, in a world fully of wandering templates and preventions, they have to withstand to deal with divided marginals or otherwise painfully lose and replace the colony of human garbage. So this film is this actually exact episode reference to a very conservative United of Women who promote traditional and conservative way of how women should live and what they should choose. So through this concept of beauty and women's rights, they exemplifies the cultural stereotypes and humor and brought topics to discussion on the question of woman rights and desires. And in the second example, we can go further with this feministic issue and also go to another very connected topic, which is equality. And here, it's a remarkable example of movie titled Look, She Got the Beard by a Kharkiv-born and Auckland-based artist Yuli Holub, an exterminal sci-fi eco-feminist short thriller comedy film that explores such themes as climate change, refugee crisis, woman empowerment, body positivity, xenophobia. The film is situated shortly where the developer countries facing new migrants crisis due to climate change. The film begins with a controversial married couple coming home and finding a stranger sleeping in their bed. And then the first they assumed her to be a migrant, but it turns out that she is something completely different. The film explores the prejudice and fears of traditional society, introducing bearded woman who embodied otherness with the appearance and behavior. For the ones of the house, this unwelcome guests come a shock. They experience various emotional states, hospitality, confusion, compassion. However, when the hostess joins the hypnotic ritual dance with a woman, she proceeds, she accepted their differences and become a transformed to by these interactions. Her curiosity, hospitality, and transformation illustrate the possible steps toward overcoming and the rejection of otherness and potential interaction between various communities and underfilled identities. If it's possible, I can share my screen and show this trailer just to show you this example.
I'm still not seeing your screen, so I don't know if you can send the link to me or Megan and we can.
This trailer was made especially for this presentation and Yuli Golub. On a gray, gloomy day, I open my window, the fish flies away, and I know. The wind in my hair and the smile on my face, my adventure begins. Starlight in my eyes, I'm surfing on clouds, caressing the skies, I follow the fish. She's leading the way to the stars. I'm saying goodbye. I'm closing the door and not looking back. Also, maybe to imagine how it would be if some organism and even Bjorn could be an independent agent and an emancipated organism and have also rights and equals as a human being has. So we can also continue with the presentation. And go to other examples that create fiction stories and actually I should also emphasize that fictions and alternative history become also very important part, important topic for Ukrainian artists. And they try to imagine different ways of seeing their future and different ways of their reality. On the next slide, we could see another example of such work. It's Katya Buchatska installation titled Pain of Records. And it reproduces a typical room of the Natural History Museum and presented an exhibition that she called Temporary Exhibition about paleontologist William von Kollner. And according to Buchatska, von Kollner was born in Edinburgh in mid-19th century, studied paleofauna and died during the expedition under mysterious circumstances. The researchers reminds conserved of trigypsum having been presented due to the efforts of his assistants. So you can see in this picture that her exhibition has three objects. One of these, it's a dead body of this von Kollner, a paleontologist. So using only three this object, the artist tells the personal story from the 19th century, far removed from her own context. In her practice, Katya Buchatska often works with the topic of time, applies to the methods of media and archaeology, and uses the tactic of soft intervention of the environment. Artists draw attention to the found objects on its archaeological distance and raises the questions of their meaning for the contemporary viewer, the role of the authors and its kind of artistic gesture and ability to perceive the drama hidden behind the objects when you on the one side of the glass care. And also for this type of artworks, it's very important to create a total exhibition where viewer can be totally involved to the process and to feel the art itself. On the second reason of creating fiction stories is the reason of rethinking reality and escapism. And during the Maidan, an underground culture developed. Young people manifested their joy of life and freedom in the music, cinema, art, and parties. This transgression was documented by a young Ukrainian artist, Sasha Kurmas, who also a Malevich Prize winner from 2012. So on the next slide, we can see one of his pictures. So he started his project in 2009, even much more earlier, but he started documenting this young life of people who was born almost at the end of Soviet Union, but also life of super young people who like 20 years old or even younger. And for Sasha Kurmas, it's very essential to reflect on their desires and their life of how do they react on different political and cultural events, and also how do they try to deal with the Soviet past, which is very essential to the artist. For the most part, I'm interested in the interior of human being and his social manifestation on post-Soviet society, Kurmas commented. On his project, he always tried to show these emotional conditions of young people. But according to another artist, Anna Zvyagintseva, we can go to another site, slide. She trying to see something smaller and fragile and to make it more way to give more value to this. Like, for example, in her resin sculpture, My Father's Sculpture was realized in 2012 in Lviv region. She dedicated to symbolic sculptures that her father, who is also an artist, automatically made from small pieces of paper and candy wrapper. In another her project titled Misplaced Touches, it based on idea of a trail and trace, an uncompromising following somebody else parts and the parts of emerge from of them in practical touches. So we can see on the next slide, the exhibition view of her Misplaced Touches project made in the Pinchukar Center exhibition. So this is how people, it's sort of a sculpture made from the gypsum that follows with other pictures and videos that shows her method, how she making this. So it's how two legs, for example, touching each other. Exploring this topic of touches and symbolic and fragile things, she tried to give value to something that we somehow missed from our life. Going further to another topic, which is post-industrial heritage and post-industrial culture, I will tell you about Daniil Rivkovsky and Andriy Rachinsky project called Tailing Down. It's the next slide. And their artwork, they takes the shape of a museum of human civilization, which is established by the figures after humans go explicit. The museum is dedicated to the future archaeology of the Tailing Down in Kryvyi Rih, which is also very connected to Katya Buchatska's works. In Tailing Down, in its system of the special facilities for storing radioactive, toxic, and other non-recyclable waste from mineral processing, the work touches upon the issues of people's responsibility for the nature resources and the chemical forms of imprint of human activity on the earth may acquire. This section of the Museum of Human Civilization adds the critical elements of the search of causes and experience and the extension of human civilization and it's assumed that the humans extract minerals and the materials from the earth, and after the process of achievement, dumped untreated and uncovered waste onto the soil. And in doing so, human civilization prevalently changed the landscape on the world and was presumably a reason for this demise. So for Daniil Rivkovsky and Andriy Rachinsky, two authors who was born and based in Kharkiv, it's very essential to talk about post-industrial heritage and also ecological topic. Mostly all of last their works, and also I could say now that it's a corpus of their works, is very connected to Kryvyi Rih and Dnipro and some other cities, which is in the center of Ukraine and has this like industrial heritage. Another example, it's a video made by Yarema Malashuk and Roma Himei. And it's titled, So They Won't Say We Don't Remember, 2021. And it's dedicated to them, to contemporary Donbas. So in this movie, they show the landscape as a monument. And it's a film, people walk across the city and in their work very similar to underground way of miners. And the end point of this trip is a monument made by to honor to miners that tragically pursued during the underground collapse in 1977. During the journey, the landscape changed. The urban space is replaced by the rural landscapes and single-story buildings, quiet streets, fields, and shrubs. The authors define the moving image as a closely connection, the hidden and visible of the post-industrial landscape of Donbas. On one hand, this mechanical course of the Soviet therapeutic conversation of the traumatic memory, which is also associated with violent industrialization. On other hand, it's a biblical search for one's place or search for lost home, the home of Mirnograd. The town of Mirnograd, which was founded in 1911 and became a town of post-war period in 1965, is a typical town for the Donetsk region with a coal industry complex. The Novator mine has turned into the town district at the same name. In the first year of the urban transition, tragedy occurred. A part of the spoil tip was destroyed, which led to the destruction of houses and three streets. People who were the home at the time was died. The press did not cover this accident and the state was keeping silent about every such tragedies. And I began my lecture with the work of Vova Vorotnyov, That's Heat, and talking about the walking. And in this final work and the presentation, I'm also talking about this like walking gesture, the gesture of solidarity and unity. Both artworks seem to me as a symbolic, and the Ukrainian context has emphasized the desire to find their own places or homes, ground and roots, but also connection to the human history itself. So thank you for listening to me, and sorry for this technical troubles.
Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing such a diverse set of artists and of kinds of art. I think there's a lot of material to engage with there for the audience. Please feel free to submit your questions on the Q&A function on Zoom here and on YouTube via the chat. I'll start out with a question that I was thinking about. I have a couple of themes to pick up on from the presentation, but my first question is about the audience for this artwork, because I feel like on the one hand, many of the messages are really important for a Ukrainian audience to hear and to see the way that artists are engaging with those themes. But at the same time, there's also, it seems to be an audience geared toward a European audience or North American audience who may not understand why making these claims are so important for Ukrainian artists. So can you talk a little bit about how you see the audience of these artists and artworks and how they see them as well?
Yes, thank you for a question. In the beginning, I should say that probably we have so a few institutions where artists can show works. It's true, and it's not enough for them, and it's not all artists can be presented there. This is like how Ukrainian situations go now, but it's not means that they doing their art mostly for artists, just showing to each other. So it just seems that for artists, it's audience question, it's important, but it's not essential. So they're talking about different problems like ecology, post-industrial heritage, feminism, and others, just because they really want to say this. I would say that probably they're very free to talking about different questions just because of this like lack of institutions and everything. Maybe in another situation they would be talking about other things, but to me it was very to my point of view, they really developing the art in a connection to like global processes, even maybe for some years later, but still very connected to all the processes is going on now everywhere.
So related to that question, we have a question from Alexander Zavalov, who wants to know if you can talk a little bit more about how contemporary art is impacting Ukrainian society. And do you see that the Pinchuk Art Center in particular serves as a catalyst for social impact?
Of course, I want to say that yes, we're doing a lot of things that has an impact because I was working there, but it's also a yes and no, because we have a huge audience and they also come to see our exhibition. And also we have a prize which goes on each 2 years. For young artists, it's like special, one main prize, two special prize, and one prize of from the audience. And also for this prize, we're making a huge exhibition for 20 artists and invest some fundings to the production of work. So some impact we're doing, so I could say yes. But also, I want to say that I really want to have not only one Pinchuk Art Center in Ukraine. So like my dream is like very developed Ukrainian cultural institution situation. So it's very important to go now to regions, and it's probably I should mention that we have now some institutions that are growing. It's Art Suite in Dnipro, and very soon it would be open Fabrika Povidla in Lviv. So it would be probably more institutions that working with contemporary art. And also, but also I want to say that for many artists, it's not maybe so essential to be in a huge institution, but also it's very important to develop in their own like society. So that's why they're making this small organization like Method Fund, for example, or Atelier Normalna, just help to each other to like going further to develop their works, and also to have a discussion about art. Have some support from the artistic environment and to feel this like that they're not alone in this field.
Thank you. A question from Jennifer Kahn. I'm curious about the generational differences, if any, in terms of how artists are addressing these themes. So I know to some extent, a lot of these are very young artists or born just before the end of the Soviet Union or right after the Soviet Union. Is that generally correct? Are there artists of different generations coming together?
Also, and yes and no, because in my presentation, it was a couple of examples of artists who was started in the 90s, for example, like Vlada Ralko. She is actually an incredible artist, and I really, yeah, if you want to go and see her works, you can definitely Google her. She's amazing. She's doing a lot of works reflecting on war and violence situation. Another artist that I mentioned, Valentina, she's also... I mean, I could say old generation, right? This is not fair, but she a little bit more experienced than other artists. So she also working with such topic because of, I started talking about her project about her mother. So it's somehow like made a huge corpus of her work, but also she now talking about the democracy at all, and also like ecosystem and ecology. And she's very also talented and experienced artist. About young artists here, maybe it could be more broader topic, because they of course they're different. They are trying to talk about different questions, like also they are very going worked very essentially to a current situation. Like, for example, Sasha Papruga, she's super young artist. She just started doing art with refused and plastic materials. So she's doing sculptures. So they really try to react on the situation, what's going on now. But also I should really emphasize that they're not looking to Ukrainian situation just as a local situation, but also they look into this like as a part of huge world. And also another word that I didn't mention in my presentation, but it's also very important. It's Geocinema project. It's made by Asa Bazdareva and her colleague Solvi. So it's an international artistic group, and they're talking about post-industrial heritage, not only due to the context of Ukraine, but also they're talking a lot about Asian situation. So it's not like very local, and it's interesting that Ukrainian art is going further, not only consistent from Ukrainian issues.
Yeah, I think that's actually really notable. So I was thinking about the next question myself from Susana Torres Prieto, who's one of our current fellows at HURI. So she says, thank you for such an amazing presentation, and then mentions a wonderful exhibit that she attended in 2018 at Pinchuk Art Center, A Space of One's Own. Those of you who haven't heard about this exhibit, hopefully there's some materials online. It focused on women artists. It's without a doubt one of the best that Susana has seen in recent years. The variety of techniques used, from filming to traditional embroidery, the messages and rich Western references from Wolf to Ibsen, made it unique. So her question is, do you think that women are finding a new and maybe a better language in art, rather than spaces that are traditionally monopolized by male voices, such as the press or the media? And I would just reiterate in this question, I mean, you featured very many women artists in your talk, which I think is important. And you also mentioned feminism as being a theme that women are allowed to address through art, which we know that feminism isn't always that easy for women in Ukraine to engage with. And thanks, Susana, for sharing that link.
Oh, yeah, thank you for this question. This is like maybe the main question to me, because I'm very connected to the feminist topic in Ukrainian art. And also after this exhibition, we did a book which called Why Ukraine Has a Great Woman Artist. I see now, and I think that we have a huge movement of Ukrainian contemporary artists, women artists, and they reflected on these topics. Some of them not really, and they're still scaring to call themselves as a feminist, but I'm thinking that if they're doing art and they're trying to show their work, they are feminist. So from this perspective, yes. But also I should say that being now artists in Ukraine, it's very interesting, because they really have explored different topics. But also what's more important to female artists is that they are Well, if I would say this, maybe some male artists will kill me after that, but I think that they really more creative in artistic field, and they're trying to like see some, as Anya Zvagintseva, for example, seeing some very fragile and not visible things, just give some attention to something that was not important before, which is it appears to feministic research and feministic agenda, right? Because they try include a lot of different opinions and create a discussion more like complex and broader. So I think that this is like what happening now in Ukrainian art, because like artists really try to engage different actors and different players to the discussions. And yeah, according to like illegal film, you can see how she created this like bearded woman just to show this otherness, but also in this way she tried to talk about the ecological problems, for example. I hope I answered this question.
And I, if you don't mind me tacking a little bit onto that, I was reading recently something that kind of mentioned the diary as a female art form, which I think one can take issue with, but you featured two women artists who use that kind of diary mechanism. Alatina Kahidze and Vladivalko both did a kind of diary, daily storytelling mechanism, which I think is just a kind of interesting, tool that allows women to document these everyday things, which on the one hand sort of shows what feminist scholars might criticize as a kind of like women being obligated to show a more private life rather than a more public life, right? Which is something women are often relegated to, a kind of private engagement where men are perceived to be participating in the public sphere. And I think a diary sort of does that if it's seen as a women's mechanism. But at the same time, what you've documented are the ways that these diaries draw out everyday themes of living under occupation, living through war, right? So very public, very kind of male-dominated narratives, women use these diary forms to have their own part in the conversation. Would you agree or push back?
Yeah, actually, I think that the private is the political in this case. I mean, especially if it's connected to war. So talking about her personal, I'm sure that it was quite difficult to Alevtina Kahidze to talk about her mother's situation and also describe all the difficulties. And also, because it's Facebook, I mean, also like some angry and even envy comments come up, and like talking about why you do not brought your mother to Kyiv, or why you didn't do this, why you didn't. So they're not talking about her art even. They're talking about if she's a good daughter or not, which is like completely not their discussion, right? So I think it was quite difficult, but even though Alevtina Kahidze did this project and talk about her mother, and even she tried to not react on these comments, she really creates a document of the time, and she really helps to change the situation around the stereotypes, and even the situation with the pensions that now people can got it. So I think she really did a huge job with this.
Yeah, that's a great connection. So we have a question here from Elena Martinyuk, who this is also a question that I was thinking about while listening. So reconsidering the Soviet past is so compelling for the generation. Why do you think that is? Decommunization laws and the Donbas war, obvious reasons, but is there anything else that you find kind of behind the push toward thinking about and engaging with the Soviet past?
I actually think that this like historical topics come up much more earlier, but maybe that was connected not so clear to Soviet heritage and Soviet past as it now, because now it's more like direct and maybe more how to say. So yeah, it's more focused on what we should do with this cultural heritage and what we can see our past from the lens of nowadays. But yeah, Olena Martinuk knows that in the 90s and 80s, many artists who reflected to Ukrainian history. I mean, it was different history, not probably Soviet, but also they used some like mass cultural products and topics from the Soviet times. So they was presented, but maybe not so like not as big as now.
Thank you. Yeah, I think I think that's really a trend that hopefully people who are studying contemporary art will follow, because I think as these decommunization laws, you know, have been being played out, there's also, as many of you on here probably know, a push to look at architectural heritage from the Soviet period as valuable to Ukraine. And probably there's something similar going on in terms of exhibiting Soviet art. You know, there people have been able to find kind of complex relationships with Ukrainian Soviet heritage, right?
Yeah.
But it's not all about, you know, the narrative is much more complicated. People's relationship with those pieces are a lot more complicated.
But also I'm thinking that really for some artists, it's need to have a time from like some topics just to like not being during these events, not reflecting just now, but also have this like distance from the past. So now having this discussion of Ukrainian Soviet memory, now we have this distance and we can see how it was changed and what's going on now. And probably this is like a kind of reactions what was going on during the first Maidan and the second Maidan.
And so to follow up on that, I mean, how do you, you mentioned Euromaidan as a really essential moment for triggering a lot of what you talked about in your presentation, but what, how else might we reflect on that time period? Do you have any speculation about what might happen in the future and when we get that distance from the 2013 and 2014 protests? Because right now they still seem very alive, I think, in a lot of ways.
Yeah, to be honest, I don't think that now we somehow will have this distance, because war is a part of Maidan, right? It's like developing now and going on. So probably after war was finished, we will have this distance to see all the event. But also, like looking now to this art, we can see different point of views of artists on the Euromaidan. In the beginning, it was like really a lot of art that was made like this, like reflective and mechanical drawings and some like maybe actions and performances that was reacting on that situation. But now it's maybe more analytical, more deeply artworks.
Interesting. We have just a couple more minutes if anyone else would like to submit a question. In the meantime, can you talk a little bit about your current Fulbright project and what you're doing at the Shevchenko Scientific Society?
Yes, thank you for this. And I really appreciate that Shevchenko Society give me this possibility to come this year, even this situation of Corona happened. So I'm doing, my research is connected to the image of violence in photography, mostly female photography and art. And I'm talking with different artists, how do they solve this dilemma of ethic and aesthetic, and how do they solve the problem of self-censorship and censorship, what's emotions and what images they use for describing fear and violence, and how empathy comes up after that. So it's actually started when I was working and talk a lot with Valentina Kahidze also. So we have, as you mentioned, and somebody asked the question about the female artists. So we have really many artists, women artists who talking with working with war topic, and some of them even people who was displaced by war. So they started shooting and filming after that, just as a part of self-therapy or something like that.
Great. And for those of you who are listening here, please do sign up for our listserv. I'll include a little note featuring the names of some of the artists that were in this presentation. So if you'd like to look them up any further, you'll have that information. And I'm really glad to see that some of you have been introduced to new artists that you haven't heard from before. And I hope you'll be able to follow their careers, because you've really given us this great image of how diverse and how engaged and active the contemporary art community is. So thank you so much. I think we'll go ahead and end here. Thanks so much for everybody who stuck with us through our small technological errors. Please do join us next week. We'll be shifting gears to energy politics. We'll have Margarita Balmaceda speaking with us about Ukraine's coal-steel nexus between regional oligarchs and global markets. So that will also be here on Zoom on the 27th of October, 12 to 1:15 p.m. You can sign up for the Zoom webinar online, or you can watch us on YouTube. Thanks everybody for coming. Thanks, Kateryna, for your wonderful presentation.
Thank you.
And best of luck with your research.